Hello, I'm going to be showing you a guideline to estimate the amount of dump space to allocate to your ZVM system, how to allocate that dump space, and a couple methods to monitor your dump space. I'll be covering 3390 disks, aka ECKD or FICON DASD, and more specifically Model 9s, or Mod 9s for short, which are 10,017 cylinders. If you use FCP SCSI emulated devices, or EDEVs, the concept is similar but with different units. For more information on that and dump space in general, please read Chapter 23 of CP Planning and Admin. A disclaimer, the system I'm using is purely for demonstration purposes and may or may not follow best practices. Production systems will vary. So what is dump space and why do you need it? It's spool space allocated exclusively for dump storage and is very important because a dump is crucial to IBM debugging a problem if you run into one. And by the way, whenever I say real or virtual storage, I'm referring to what most call memory outside of IBM Zland. So if you don't have enough dump space and a dump is produced, it will just not be saved. Many things can influence the size of a dump, and therefore how much dump space you should allocate, such as the amount of real storage your ZVM system has, the number of virtual machines running, and how much virtual storage they each have, what workloads they're running, etc. Therefore, it is very difficult to give a broad rule of thumb. However, this video is a place to start. Afterwards, you should read Chapter 23 of CP Planning and Admin, look closer at your system, and assess your risk tolerance to come to a more tailored amount of dump space. So let's log on to a user with any one of priv classes A, B, or E. And I'll be using mate720. So this is all the guideline is. Generally speaking, except for the first 250 gigs of storage, for every 250 gigs of storage your ZVM system has, you should allocate one 3390 mod 9 of dump space. And we move to two mod 9s at 129 gigs instead of 251 due to dump data collected by our leading dump developer. And depending on where your storage amount falls within its range, it will vary between 3 and 6% of real storage. And unless your system runs large workloads, which very well may be the case, it should allow for two dumps. And this guideline, and I'll repeat, guideline, is based on Mod 9s because Mod 9s are gradually replacing Mod 3s as the most common ECKD size used, as Mod 3s can't be used for ZVM installs anymore. And it's easier to remember a number of Mod 9s as opposed to a very large cylinder amount. And it is also best practice to allocate entire volumes as dump space. So if you don't know how much real storage your ZVM system has, you can issue the CP query store command with priv classes A, B, or E to find out. And one thing to note is if you are taking advantage of dynamic memory and in the future may use any reserved or standby storage, you should include that storage in your calculations. So to see if there's enough dump space for one dump at this very moment, you can use the CP query dump command. And if there isn't enough space, it will tell you and make it obvious. So you see, I do have enough space for at least one dump, and this is where it would be stored if it were to happen. Let's take a look at those volumes with CP query alloc spool. So I currently don't have any dump volumes, meaning dumps will be stored in normal spool space. And I know that because there is no dump keyword here after the percentage use column for any spool volume. And we don't want that because spool can be filled with other things and we want guaranteed space. So my system has 1 terabyte of real storage. So we'll follow the guideline and dynamically allocate 4 volumes, DogBaker14 through DogBaker17. And they're going to be CP owned volumes. we'll issue pipe CP query CP owned and locate observed. Send that to the console. And we're doing this to find four free slots. And I'm using a pipe to isolate the slots in use, as opposed to just issuing CP query CP owned by itself. You get the same information with a lot less output this way. So you should follow the slot assignment convention already established on your system. This demo system doesn't have one, so I'm just choosing 40 through 43 arbitrarily. So to add CP owned volumes, you need to know the volume ID of each pack, because that's what CP actually cares about, not the rdev. So you can just query them. This and the volume IDs show up right here. Also, the allocation map on each should be cylinders 1 to end as spool, S-P-O-L. And you can do that with the CPFMTXA utility that lives on PMaint's 551 disk. And if your system is part of an SSI, you'll have to define the owner of these disks as your system, again, with this utility. Mine are already properly allocated, so I won't be showing that step. And so to add them, we'll use the CP define CP owned command like this, slot 40, volume ID, and the dump keyword. And I'll repeat that three more times for the other volumes. Okay, and the dump keyword makes all spool space on that pack reserved for dumps. And we need to make sure these volumes are attached to system. So we'll do cp attach system. And by the way, it is good practice to give your CP owned volumes non-generic vol IDs that relate to the system it's being used on, in cases it's accessible from multiple LPARs. So now we should see our packs with CP query alloc spool. And we do see them, and they all have the dump keyword. So we've defined these dump packs dynamically, but they won't survive a reIPL. So we need to define them in the system config as well. So let's bring that up. Okay, here's my system config. I'll just skip down here. So I already have made the changes. You can see you just add, use the CP owned keyword, and you just add the dump keyword to the end of it. And that's all you have to do. And don't forget to run CP syntax against the system config after making changes. How do you check to see if any dumps exist? Well, with priv class D, you can issue query reader class D all short date. And we see two shell files, both with zero records. And these are files waiting for dumps to be written to them. You'll know you have a dump when either of these have more than zero records. And in the type column, we see CP dump, and this is for hard abends and snap dumps. And HTTP dump is for soft abends. So you can change dump parameters with the CP set dump command. Frame table default says that when a hard abend does occur, the full CP frame table, which is a map of real memory, is included in the dump only in cases IBM believes the frame table is needed for debug. And the same goes for PGMBKS default, which are page management blocks. Running with both set to default is recommended unless otherwise directed by IBM. Including these two things when they're not needed can drastically increase the size of your dump. So we'll issue that. And now if we do cp query alloc spool, we see that space is now occupied on our dump volumes, on two of them anyway. And that doesn't mean we have a dump, it's just cp claiming space to store the next dump. So now if we do a cp query dump, again we see we have space and on our new volumes. It would be a good idea to create automation to periodically issue this query dump command and alert if it indicates insufficient space. The need for dump space changes as the use of the system changes. So having sufficient dump space now does not guarantee it will be sufficient 3 months from now. So that's all for this video. As a reminder, every ZVM environment is different and therefore will require a different amount of dump space. The more storage and I/O a system uses, the more dump space will be needed. Please thoroughly read the dump section of Chapter 23 of CP Planning and Admin before deciding how much dump space to allocate to your system. Thanks for watching.